Hi there, John Hardy here with the FX market update for January 27th, 2011. Plenty going on today. Overnight, we had an S&P downgrade on the Japan sovereign debt. They downgraded to one notch to AA minus. You could say on the positive side that that this merely reverses the upgrade that was from 2007. Although you have to argue that Japan's sovereign debt situation is far worse now than it was before 2007, because every year they're not taking in anywhere near what they're spending. I think it's 25% or so of their budget simply goes to cover interest on their debt, and that's even at these incredibly low interest rates. So you can imagine as this piles up, this becomes an unsustainable situation. Still, all in all, this is an S&P downgrade. These bond rating agencies carrying less and less weight ever since the financial crisis. And the reaction in the actual bond market was very modest compared to what we saw in the currency market. We saw a pretty big move here, and this is dollar yen. I think some of this move aggravated by the fact that we didn't break lower. We broke some technical areas yesterday, and then below the Ichimoku cloud, other levels, and then this downgrade was used as an excuse to stop out the shorts, taking it back up to the 55-day moving average, the red line here. But really, if we look at, this is the two-year Japanese swaps. They came up a tad, maybe 2 bips, back down to where they were. No reaction bonds. And if we look at credit default swaps on sovereign debt, the spread here, this is the blue line, we see that it's actually gone down in favor of Japan versus the U.S. Now, this doesn't include today's information where we apparently had, according to a Bloomberg article, about a 4-point increase on the Japanese swaps. That would put it up here. Still, though, not a massive support either way, and it really looks uncertain on dollar yen right here from a technical perspective where we're headed. And we've been talking about bonds a lot lately. Still think the upside story in dollar yen really would need to for interest rates to head higher to get good fundamental support. And if they head lower, then it becomes a question of the relative sovereign debt situation. Moving on, the Reserve Bank of New Zealand out with some not incredibly interesting comments, but there was a decent reaction in the market. Pretty much a cautious on the outlook for rates. Inflation, they seem very comfortable in inflation, but they do suggest that higher rates are on the way. But there is, quote-unquote, no hurry. It'll be linked to economic strength. Their comments, though, on the economy were pretty strong, so linking those two together, we did get a reaction in the forward interest rate expectations, which rose about 4 or 5 bips. And if we look at a Kiwi dollar here, it's back higher today. It makes a little bit of sense with the risk appetite heading to new highs today. We had S&P pushing higher, the upgrade by the RBNZ, or at least the market's upgrade of the outlook. What have you, we have Kiwi pushing the top of this range. Again, we had some negative U.S. Jobless claims reports as well. This shows the spread on the 2-year swap, and then we're seeing, of course, that we've shown this before as well, that the spreads suggest, the blue being the spreads, that we should have come up a little bit from the recent lows. We've never really corrected as low as the old correlations suggested we should have. So a bit of a divergence there, but I think if you're going to look for any kind of Kiwi dollar sell-off, you really need to see risk going down and not be seeing these new multi-year highs in the Dow Jones Industrials, for example. And we'll get to some risk appetite measures later, but again, it's not so much about the spreads as it is about risk, I think, for currency pairs like Kiwi versus the dollar right here. Against the Aussie, very interesting. We've talked about this a couple times. Aussie Kiwi, we saw this big top here last December where it headed to new highs all the way up to 135. I think it barely touched. That was wiped out, came back below 132. Since then, back to the 55-day moving average, which served as resistance. Again, a good follow-through lower here. Next focus is obviously the 200-day moving average in this low here, which is somewhere around 126 plus. And I think a good argument from a valuation perspective. Not so much yet from an interest rate to relative interest rate perspective for lower levels still there. Moving along to the U.S. jobless claims today, very, very, very ugly data point. 454,000 versus expected 405. This is the worst number in seasonally adjusted, and that's seasonal with a capital S, really. But still, the worst level in the seasonally adjusted claims number since late October. And this isn't very good relative to the seasonal levels. If we look here, we've charted in red the non-adjusted, non-seasonally adjusted claims numbers, which you can see spike at this time of the year as the people hired for Christmas are then laid off afterwards. And what we're seeing now is that the fall has been less sharp than hoped for. That's on the right axis. So actually we're running at 500K, or just under 500K in absolute terms. The blue showing that we're at 450 on seasonally adjusted terms. So we can expect a continued drop in the absolute numbers, but again, very worrisome that we're back showing multi-month highs in claims. That's not good. Not good for the dollar either, as long as risk appetite is high, because it obviously keeps the Fed in a very easy mode and the interest rate spreads working against the dollar, although I think still risk is a key parameter for the dollar picture right now. On the euro, the reason we're still trading this high, 137.50, besides yesterday's complete lack of interesting developments in the FOMC, we didn't even get a single dissenting vote out of the FOMC. That didn't help the dollar's case. Again, with risk appetite still so high, this is another aggravating factor. And we have interest rate expectations for the euro still very, very high at the same time. So the spreads, again, arguing for euro-dollar higher. This is also going against, I think, a consensus trade out there, which is that the euro, that the ECB needs to ease if it wants to solve the sovereign debt crisis rather than tightening. But reality versus expectations are very different here, and that is the cause of this euro, continued euro strength. As well, we have stable PIGS debt spreads. The CDS price is not showing any problematic developments. One interesting comment out overnight was the ECB's Novotny saying that too much was being put into expectations for a new rescue fund. Nobody listening on that account, apparently. And as well, we have to wonder if oil prices are some kind of driver here, because we have to remember back in 2008 when the economy was basically falling off a cliff in the U.S., you still had the ECB hiking in July, just as crude oil prices were about to turn around and fall by $115 a barrel, and as clearly economic problems were very significant in the U.S., the ECB was the last major central bank that I recall, anyway, hiking in that environment. And here we see through the eyes of the March 2012 Euribor future, falling prices, meaning rising short interest rates expectations for that time frame. So, again, some fundamental support there for the euro-dollar rally. As well, here is a picture of Brent. We need to make sure it's Brent crude that we know we're talking about here, not the West Texas Intermediate, which is the U.S. crude grade and is often more closely followed. This is more of a world-grade crude that much of the world is indexed to. It's still close to $100 and close to the top of the range, while the West Texas Intermediate is trading some $12 lower, or at least $10 lower, I think, for this month. That is a gigantic spread, so let's not be misled. Crude oil is still an issue for the rest of the world, and something I think Trichet is worried about as well in terms of inflation. Technical basis, everybody's talking about the 137.40, which was the 618 Fibo. We hit that, slightly exceeded it, and this is a classic Fibonacci retracement area. Sometimes the euro dollar likes to go to the 7.64, which puts it up closer to 139.50. Really, technically, there's not much to go on here. And again, we'd like to see a fundamental turnaround in some of these interest rate spreads, a new round of fear about PIGS, sovereign debt crisis, something to have a toehold on to see why this euro dollar should trade lower. Even though, again, the background, we can't believe that this is the case. We have a hard time believing that the market is going to continue to bid up the tighter and tighter ECB story and higher interest rate spreads versus the rest of the world from the Eurozone, but that's reality is what reality is. Looking ahead, we have the U.S. GDP tomorrow. This is a lot of focus. I never understand why, because this is the last 3 months. It has no forward impact, but nonetheless, it's a focus. First reading of Q4 GDP expected, I think, at 3.5% on the consensus. Risk appetite still very heavily bid And we wonder if sentiment is too high, but we have an interesting look at that. First of all, risk appetite, our measure, the carry trade model, showing this the red level being the longer-term level, close to these the all-time highs for this index, showing that risk appetite is still very, very strong out there. We've seen a lot of divergences. Sometimes this can be a mean reversion indicator, but basically what it's showing us is there's no strong reason or strong evidence of anything but strong risk appetite at the moment. So we'll keep an eye on that for you. And then on the subject of sentiment, we recently actually poked through to a new high in this widely followed weekly AAII survey of investors, higher than actually the all-time market tops back in October of 2007. But now we've corrected quite a bit lower, but not seeing much of an evidence of correction in the actual equity market. So we're wondering what the value of that was for trying to pick a sort of risk appetite or equity market top based on the sentiment measure. That's rather interesting. And it appears that the liquidity game is still running strong until proven otherwise. That about does it for today. Check back with us whenever you feel like it on TradingFloor.com, and you can follow me on Twitter at John J. Hardy.